upstate New York, November 1957. In the sleepy town of Appalachian, an extraordinary meeting was taking place. Gathered in the garden of one of the town's wealthiest residents, a gang of sharp-dressed businessmen feasted on several hundred pounds of steak. This unusual group attracted attention, and the local cops looked on astonished. What they didn't know was that they were witnessing a summit meeting of the entire leadership of the American Mafia. In fact, until that moment, many denied the Mafia even existed. Sure, there was crime, but organized crime, a criminal gang with secret initiation rites and codes enforced by sentence of death, seemed like something out of the movies. Across the Atlantic in Sicily, things were much the same. Here in the birthplace of the Mafia, its influence reached into every corner of life. Yet its very existence was often denied. Secrecy and internal discipline gave the Mafia its power. And this power was about to go global. 1957 marked the moment the American and Sicilian mafias became international, forming a billion-dollar crime corporation. It was a turning point in another way, too. It signaled the start of a war against organized crime that would last almost half a century, a war that forced both the US and Italy finally to confront the terrifying criminal conspiracy in their midst. The United States in the mid-1950s. The good times were here. The country had emerged from depression and World War with a booming economy. For many ordinary men and women, the American dream had become a reality. But something else was booming too. The Mafia. For those growing up in a family associated with the mob, it was as if the outside world barely existed, apart from being a source of easy money. The Mafia is organized in groups called families. The head of the family is known as the boss, or the godfather. And the longest-serving New York boss of all time was Joe Bonanno, known as Joe Bananas. He ran the Bonanno family from the early 1930s until the mid-1960s. Bonanno's power was founded on the influence he wielded over his community in New York. His son, Bill, saw firsthand how his father operated and himself became a leading gangster with the Bonanno family.
My father would, on Tuesdays and Thursdays, would go into this hall and sit in an office in the back, and various people from the neighborhood would come in and ask favors. Somebody had a sick child and she couldn't pay the doctor. And my father would arrange for that. Somebody else had a husband who was cheating on her and she wanted to know what to do. He would take care of that. That happened twice a week. So when that happens, you begin to form the ideas that when you have a problem, you know where to go.
This is home movie footage, shot in Brooklyn in 1957. It looks like any ordinary American family, enjoying the new prosperity. But looks can be deceiving. Dominic Montilio was born into a mob family in New York. Some of his relatives were senior mobsters in the Gambino crime family, another of America's leading mafia families. Montilio was aware from an early age how his relatives were unlike others in the neighborhood.
I grew up in a very traditional mob family, and it was a very different kind of life than my other friends had. You know, I noticed that from the beginning, because there was times when Well, the FBI would break down the door because, I mean, we lived in the same house with my uncle, and he was very connected.
Montilio's uncle was an up-and-coming gangster called Nino Gaggi. One day when he was 11, Dominic ran home, bursting to tell his uncle Nino that he had been elected class president at school.
I came home all excited because I had the button, you know, it said president on it. And he said, oh, great. He says, what does the class president do? So I said, you know, teacher goes out of the room and you watch the class. If anybody does anything wrong, you write their name on the board. And he looked at me and he says, are you telling me you're a rat? You're a stool pigeon. So I said, I mean, 10 years old, 11 years old, what are you going to say? And he said, well, tomorrow you got to go back and give that button back to the teacher and tell her you can't be the class president.
Bill Bonanno and Dominic Montilio both grew up in a world closed to the outside. The American mafia called itself Cosa Nostra, our thing. But this was a world imported to America from several thousand miles away. This is where the mafia came from. Sicily, the largest island in the Mediterranean, with a population of 5 million, less than 2 miles from the Italian mainland. Like Montilio, Leo Luca Orlando was born in 1947, in Palermo, Sicily's biggest city. Unlike Montilio, he would grow up to fight the mafia, not join it.
Sicily is a land of contradictions. Palermo is the capital of Sicily. It's the capital of the mafia, too. It's the capital of the history. It's the capital of the shame of this land.
In the Sicilian dialect, mafioso once meant bold or beautiful. From the 1860s, it became the name associated with the island's criminal element, who were often organized into families of men related by blood or marriage. But their existence was steeped in secrecy. Even discussing the mafia was taboo, as Orlando found one day at school.
When I was 15 years old, I organized with other students a seminar about the mafia and against the mafia. The director, the Jesuit director of the school, called my parents and said, it is a scandal. Why Lucchetto is speaking about the mafia? We have nothing to do with the mafia, therefore we are not to speak about the mafia. Gray area, not seeing, not speaking, not hearing. It was Sicily when I was a young student.
Joe Bonanno grew up in this world. He was a native Sicilian, born here in the pretty seaside town of Castellammare del Golfo in 1905. He only moved to America in the 1920s.
Sicily has a long history of mistrust of authority. There's an old saying back there that to know a man, you have to know his father, and his father before him, and his father before him. And once that happens, there is very little room for betrayal.
Much of the power of the mafia derived from its ruthless discipline. Chief among these values was omerta, the vow of silence. In Sicily, all mafiosi had to take a sacred blood oath that they would never betray the organization to the authorities, and that they would always carry out the orders of their mob bosses. The novice was sworn in through a quasi-religious ceremony and became a so-called man of honor. The American mafia followed exactly the same traditional initiation ceremony.
You're brought into a room and you're given the image of a saint. Prick your finger, enough to draw a drop or two of blood, put it on the image of the saint, put the saint in your hand, and they light it. And you take an oath, and it simply says that you you hope to burn as this saint is burning if you betray your brothers.
To break this oath would mean death.
Our culture taught us to act like men. And acting like men meant keeping your mouth shut.
But for Bonanno and his fellow gangsters, omerta was more than just a vow of silence.
omerta comes from being from the root manly, and it simply means to act like a man. And a man doesn't get somebody else into trouble. Therefore, he doesn't say, John did it. Who hit you in the face? John hit me in the face. A man will see to it that John gets hit in the face.
Early in the 20th century, a young man was growing up in Sicily who would change the face of crime. Salvatore Lucania, born in 1897, would become infamous as Charlie Lucky Luciano, the father of the modern American mafia. His hometown of La Cara Fridi was built on the hard and dangerous work of sulfur mining. Sulfur mines were primitive places where temperatures were so high, men would work naked. Yet these deprived laborers still had to pay the mafia for the right to work. They were not alone. The owner of the mine would have paid up too. The mafia squeezed money from all walks of Sicilian life. When he was 10, Luciano was one of hundreds of thousands of Sicilians who left the poverty of the islands behind and set sail for a new life in America. He soon drifted into crime. As a teenager, Luciano joined the notorious Five Points Gang, which also boasted Al Capone as a member. It was the age of prohibition. For 13 years, it was illegal to make or sell alcohol in the United States. Luciano and other bootleggers made millions supplying Americans with as much booze as they wanted. Salvatore Lucania started calling himself Charles Luciano. He gained the nickname Lucky and the scars on his neck when he miraculously survived a knife attack and beating. He presided over his criminal kingdom from a suite in New York's luxurious Waldorf Hotel. Here, he called himself Mr. Charles Ross. And he made it to the very top in 1932 with the killing of Salvatore Maranzano, then the most powerful boss in America. But the constant battles were getting in the way of business.
If there were three Italian mobsters in the Italian neighborhood, it was an almost certain guarantee that at least two of them were going to try to kill the third. And the third was plotting against the other two. So bodies would wind up in the streets. To what purpose?
Luciano wanted the mafia families to bury their differences, not each other.
We can't make money with guns in our hand, was his expression, the expression that I heard over and over again. We can't make money with guns in our hand.
His solution was to set up a body called a commission, a mafia board of directors made up of the bosses of the five New York families, plus those of Chicago and Buffalo. Any boss with a grievance against another family could bring it to the commission. But for the plan to succeed, Luciano had to win the support of the other families, including Joe Bonanno, who had just taken over for Maranzano, the man whose killing Luciano had set up.
Because you got to remember, Luciano was an Americanized guy, so he talked that way. My dad always told me that Luciano talked just like those Americans. And he says, those guys are dead. I have no quarrel with you, and I know you don't have a quarrel with me. Therefore, past is the past, let's go on.
Joe Bonanno backed Luciano's plan and joined him on the first commission alongside Al Capone.
Luciano's conception was that he would meld Sicilian mafia mores, which formed a very tight organization, with American business methods. That's basically what he came up with, a kind of amalgam that we came to know as American mafia organized crime.
With peace, the mob could concentrate on what it knew best, making millions of dollars from its control of illegal gambling, prostitution, and extortion. Small wonder life as a mobster seemed so attractive to many growing up in post-war America. The teenage Henry Hill watched awestruck from the window of his Brooklyn home at mafiosi gathered on the street.
You know, you see those Cadillacs and, you know, and guys in suits, big black suits and diamond rings like the size of a quarter, you know, and beautiful woman. What the f*** is this, you know? So I walked over to that job, washing cars, sweeping them out, you know, just to hang out there. And that's how I, you know, start hanging out over there. It was exciting, you know?
Hill would become a mobster with the Lucchese family. Another future gangster, Frank Culotta, was also in awe of the mobsters he saw as he was growing up in Chicago.
Well, actually, I grew up into that world. The neighborhood I came from, there were all outfit guys, crooks, murderers. And I sort of looked up to them and idolized them. I used to shine their shoes. They'd give me, instead of a nickel, they'd give me a dollar. So, I seen a lot of money then as a kid, and they impressed me. So in my mind, I always wanted to be something like that.
The ruthless discipline the commission brought to the world of crime meant the power of the mob grew unchecked. In New York, places like the waterfront became synonymous with mafia control. It used its control of the unions and fishing companies to make millions a year. It did the same across the city in industries such as construction, in which the Bonanno family was involved.
You'd construct a building, and you'd put in even just a 2 or 3 cent increase on the value of the cement that was used in that building, which could turn into millions of dollars.
Every yard of concrete that got poured in the city, the Gambino family, the Genovese family, everybody got a piece of that yard of concrete just through the unions.
It wasn't just one little thing, but you multiply this by hundreds and hundreds and thousands of activities that were going on throughout the country, and you got a force to be reckoned with.
In New York, the mafia seemed to have its finger in every pie.
We ran the city, basically. I mean, we could stop a building from going up, or a movie being made, a show on Broadway. You didn't do any right. You didn't do what the boss wanted you to do. You were either dead, or you were out of business. It wasn't pretty.
For the most part, the authorities denied the existence of a national criminal organization. One reason was that the mafia was busy buying protection for itself. Bill Bonanno says he would meet corrupt police officers in a restaurant to give them their bribes.
I had dinner at a little restaurant, and I was there with two other friends. And we were sitting around, and they said, "You have a look of nostalgia on your face. What's up?" I says, "You know, I used to come here in the late 40s and early 50s, and I turned around and I said, I used to sit in that corner back there, and I used to meet with a captain and two lieutenants from law enforcement. And one of them said, "Well, what were you doing here?" I said, "We were giving them their envelopes." Envelopes for what? To look the other way while we had the gambling, we had the horse racing, the bookmaking, and the numbers.
The commission was presiding over a boom time. As he rose through the ranks of the mob, Bill Bonanno attended several meetings of the commission with his father, mafia boss Joe Bonanno. The commission boasted it was so powerful that it could even influence government.
I can remember a time, and I participated in some of those meetings, and the decisions that had to be made were, you're going to be the next federal judge. You're going to be the next governor. You're going to be the next senator. You're going to be the next House of Representatives candidate. The men got up, after those decisions. And lo and behold, it happened.
The Mafia had a power that was unacknowledged and unchallenged, until the temptation to make even more money proved impossible to resist and finally forced the US government to act. In the United States and Italy in the 1950s, the Mafia controlled many aspects of life. Yet the governments in both countries barely acknowledged the existence of organized crime. Law enforcement had a different enemy. The Cold War was at its height. The main target of the FBI were American communists, not Italian-American gangsters.
Communist bloc has woven a vast network of espionage throughout the free world.
The communist line is uniform and deadly. Destroy America.
After World War II, in the FBI's New York office, there were 400 agents chasing communists. There were just five dealing with organized crime. The story was similar at the Department of Justice, where William Hundley worked.
When I took over the organized crime section in the Justice Department in 87, there were basically, maybe seven or eight lawyers there who were basically clipping newspapers. They weren't doing anything either.
The director of the FBI was J. Edgar Hoover. He had been its head for over 30 years. Hoover was one of the most powerful men in Washington, eventually serving under eight presidents. In law enforcement, what Hoover said went. And to Hoover, America's priority was the Red Menace. Hoover had almost no Italian-American agents who could infiltrate the mob. Indeed, he had few agents from any ethnic minority.
At that time, Hoover did not have one black agent. He had no female agents. Excuse me, his chauffeur was black, so he made his chauffeur an agent, so he could say he had one black agent. In essence, he had all of these waspy guys, you know, with the snap hats on and whatnot, yeah.
But from the late 1950s, a succession of events would change all that, finally forcing the authorities and the nation to acknowledge the existence of the Mafia. Once again, it all started in Sicily. And it was a story in which Mafia godfather Joe Bonanno played a central role. In late 1957, Bonanno took a trip back to his native Sicily. He had been born here in the tiny coastal town of Castellammare del Golfo before emigrating to the US as a youngster. But Bonanno's trip was no sentimental journey. The Mafia Don was on business. Joe Bonanno had maintained close links with his family and criminal associates in the old country. He was approached by some old acquaintances for advice on a pressing problem.
My dad told me that one of the leaders of the Palermo Mafia came to him and said that there's a few people that they would like to talk to him about certain problems that they're having here in Sicily.
A meeting took place in this building, the Grand Hotel de Palme in Palermo, one of the top hotels in the Sicilian capital. Even to this day, details of who attended and what was discussed remain shrouded in mystery. Bonanno may not have been the only American present. Charles Lucky Luciano was now living in Italy, having been deported from the US after the war. Today, the Italian authorities believe that he was also present at the Hotel de Palme.
From the 10th to the 16th of October 1957 in Palermo, in the Hotel de Palme, there was a summit of about 30 mafia bosses. American Cosa Nostra and Sicilian Mafia bosses.
Le maggiori famiglie americane, cioè era presente per esempio la famiglia Bonanno con il suo capo Joe Bonanno.
The major American families were represented, Joe Bonanno, Lucky Luciano, who had been in Italy since 1947, and then there were the local mafia heads.
Era presente Lucky Luciano, che era già in Italia dal 47, e poi erano presenti I capi mafia locali, I capi mafia siciliani.
Over dinner, the Sicilians explained why they wanted the meeting. This was a business convention, and high on the agenda was the subject of drugs, which offered vast profit, but at a price.
The purpose of the meeting was to pick my father's brains as to how they were going to resolve a problem they were beginning to have among each other over the narcotics trade in Turkey.
The Sicilians faced a dilemma.
Various families within the mafia were at odds as to whether they should or they shouldn't get themselves involved with this. And the younger element saw nothing wrong in making a profit.
In fact, the American mafia was having the same debate about drugs. It seems that Joe Bonanno wasn't just offering friendly advice. He was there to close a deal that would reorganize the global trade in heroin. According to the FBI, it was this meeting which established the Bonanno family as the main players in the transatlantic heroin trade. The Sicilians would manufacture and smuggle the drug into the US. The Americans would distribute it and take a cut. This was the first time the mafias on both sides of the Atlantic had come together on such a scale. An early example of globalization, but run by organized crime.
The Sicilian Connection non si parla in epoca più tardi. Possiamo dire che sono state poste.
The foundations were laid for collaboration between Sicilian Mafia, which wasn't yet called Cosa Nostra, and the American Cosa Nostra, which had as its main objective heroin trafficking.
Americana che ha al suo centro il traffico di eroina, questo senz'altro.
Bill Bonanno says the organization of the mafia itself was also on the agenda, and that his father advised the Sicilians to copy Luciano's recipe for resolving disputes.
It was at that meeting that he suggested that one of the ways that they might resolve their problem and have a little better handle on the situation is to do what the Americans had done, and that was to form a commission.
The Sicilians did set up a commission, but it would only meet a few times and never gain the authority of the American original. In America, the subject of drugs continued to dominate mafia discussions.
The new organization that Luciano created solved just about every problem you could think of, except one, narcotics. In the beginning, Luciano assumed that the organization could keep organized crime out of narcotics altogether. It simply wasn't worth the trouble. The difficulty was the money.
And for the mafia, money was always irresistible. The Americans arranged a summit to ratify the deal with their Sicilian cousins, a meeting that would provide one of the most infamous moments of their history. The deal between the Sicilian and American mafia in late 1957 was a turning point for both organizations. The money offered by the drug business was the key. Everyone knew that drug dealing was a far bigger dollar earner than other activities like illegal gambling and extortion. But it also brought with it long prison sentences. And mob bosses feared that their men would break the code of silence if they faced decades in prison.
There was friction among the various families. Some of the younger people, especially those in New York and in Boston and in Chicago, thought that this was the great new thing coming. Speaking strictly about money.
The mafia in Chicago, known as the Outfit, claimed the hardest anti-drugs line. Frank Alotta was a rising young gangster there.
At the time I was there, there was no drugs allowed to be sold, or you couldn't deal with drugs at all, or else you get whacked. Because we always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely gonna get whacked.
The mafia families called a summit in November 1957, just 1 month after the meeting with the Sicilians in Palermo. Joe Bonanno was to be joined at the summit by another godfather, Vito Genovese. Both men wanted the mob to deal in drugs.
Chief among Genovese's agenda items was narcotics. He was directly involved in narcotics. Bonanno was deeply involved in narcotics. A lot of the other bosses were on the sly involved in narcotics. And he argued, look, it's a fact of life anyway. Who are we kidding? Let's make it official. Let's really make money out of this thing.
The summit was held in a small town called Appalachian in upstate New York. The venue was a large house on a 58-acre estate owned by Joseph Barbera, a wealthy businessman and mafia associate. It was chosen because its isolated rural location seemed safe from the prying eyes of the law. Unfortunately for the mob bosses, they got that 100% wrong. For over a year, the local state police had been watching the place after they discovered that a house guest was a leading New York mobster, Carmine Galante, Joe Bonanno's underboss. On the 14th of November, officers were surprised to observe several Cadillacs without estate plates. When the state troopers went to take a closer look, they saw about 100 men enjoying a barbecue, all of them wearing dark suits, fedoras, and shiny shoes.
If you didn't know that it was a mafia summit, and you suddenly were dropped from a spaceship into the middle of this thing, you would think it's just some kind of friendly barbecue among a lot of friends who, oddly enough, seemed to be wearing suits to a barbecue, but yeah, each to his own taste.
Suddenly, someone spotted the police.
These are men that if you, like Pavlov's dogs, if you say, it's the cops, there's one instinct. That's to run. That's exactly what they did.
Pandemonium broke out. Some bosses hid. Some took to their cars. Others fled into the woods.
It was a farce. It was probably the mafia's lowest moment. The idea of all these big-time bosses running through the thickets in their sharkskin suits and their silk ties and their $500 Italian shoes. It was unbelievable.
Joe Bonanno escaped the chaos, but only because he was late.
They were coming there. When they got to the bottom of the hill, you could see all the way up the hill, and they could see these police cars and the barricades in front of the street. So they just kept on driving and went back to New York City.
Around 60 mobsters were detained, identified, and questioned. But there was little the authorities could do. Attending a barbecue was not a crime, and they were not even carrying guns. While the mobsters went free, they were convicted by the media. The next day, the gangland conference was headline news across America. Appalachian had finally provided proof of the existence and scale of the mafia.
J. Edgar Hoover, who was head of the FBI, said there is no such thing as the mafia. There is no such thing as the National Crime Organization. There is no such thing as a leadership group within this organization. Well, even he had to admit after this meeting that maybe there was something.
The extent of organized crime in the United States is a national disgrace. The very fact that we have a crime problem reflects an evil of even greater import.
It generated a lot of pressure to get something done.
In my own situation, I mean, that's why I was appointed head of the organized crime section.
Now law enforcement would have to play catch-up to come to terms with organized crime.
One of my biggest complaints was that, you know, we wanted to pool information on these people. We wanted the investigative agencies to share it. We wanted to collect it on the mafia leaders and whatnot to make our efforts to prosecute them much more feasible. Couldn't get it done. They just wouldn't do it. First of all, they didn't have anything, and second of all, they wouldn't share what they didn't have, you know.
The spotlight was now on the mafia. Before long, they would attract the attention of the president and the American public alike. In 1960, the United States went to the polls to choose a new president. It was the most hotly contested election for years. John Kennedy and his rival Richard Nixon were neck and neck in the polls. The contest was too close to call. Both candidates made every effort to get the voters out.
We are aiming our whole campaign toward the unregistered voter, to try to get those citizens who are not registered to vote, who are not even eligible to vote in this election, to get them on the books so that they can vote in November. This is a crucial area as far as Senator Kennedy is concerned.
The American mafia had influenced local politics for decades. Now seasoned gangsters suddenly got community spirit on a national stage. Chicago gangster Frank Alotta says he was told by his boss to get involved in the election.
Came around and told all us guys to reach out to all the Italian people and Polish people that they had this Irishman, Kennedy, that was running against Nixon. And we needed to get him in office. We needed all the votes we could get this guy in office.
It seemed the mafia wanted Kennedy in the Oval Office. What has never been clear is why, despite allegations of links between JFK's father, Joe Kennedy, and organized crime. Kennedy squeaked by, beating Nixon by just over 100,000 votes across the country. In Illinois, the Democrats won by just 9,000 votes. If the mafia hoped that a Kennedy administration would be easy on organized crime, the new president turned out to be a major disappointment. His younger brother, Robert, became attorney general. He had already proved to be a ferocious opponent of organized crime, from his time as counsel to the Senate Labor Rackets Committee. His appointment had an immediate impact on the FBI and its director, J. Edgar Hoover.
That's when Hoover started having his agents put in the bugs, the listening devices and whatnot, because he knew that Kennedy was going to press him very hard on organized crime.
The FBI bugged two main centers of mob activity in the U.S., Chicago and Las Vegas, where the lucrative gambling rackets were run by the Chicago mob, known as the Outfit. It was illegal to listen to private conversations, even those of suspected gangsters. But it went a long way to convincing many in the agency that the mob posed a very real threat.
These devices, of course, were illegal because they involved breaking and entering and whatnot. But the information that the FBI picked up on those devices, they might not have convinced Hoover, but they certainly convinced the FBI as an institution that there was a mafia.
Attorney General Robert Kennedy paints a grim picture of the rise of lawlessness under the Cosa Nostra, or mafia.
This was not what the mob had expected. Some mafiosi claimed that a deal had been made and broken.
I was amazed that Robert Kennedy went after organized crime so hard, because it went against everything that Robert Kennedy's father had agreed to for the help and support of getting Jack elected to the presidency.
The American government was taking a more aggressive line. but they had failed to penetrate the mob. Part of the mafia's power was based on its code of silence, known as omerta. Then the FBI got a break. It was a story that had its roots in the mafia's continuing indecision as to whether to get involved in the heroin trade. Giovellacci was a mobster with the Genovese crime family, a 30-year veteran of organized crime.
Giovellacci had a sixth-grade education. I think he committed his first crime when he was about 6 or 7 years old, broke into a grocery store, in and out of jail. But he had street smarts.
Giovellacci was a low-scale, knuckle-dragging hood who was never going to be any more than a soldier. He was never going to make the really big money.
In 1962, he was in Atlanta jail serving a prison sentence for drug dealing. He feared that his bosses were going to kill him there, for officially, the mob was still opposed to drugs. Giovellacci acted first, murdering an inmate he believed had been ordered to kill him. It was the wrong man. Whether through fear or remorse, Giovellacci broke and decided to turn government witness.
Now, the original idea was that he would become an informant for the Federal Bureau of Narcotics and tell them about other dope dealers. That's all the Bureau wanted to know, other dope dealers. That's their job. But Robert Kennedy had a brighter idea. He said, wait a minute. Let's talk to him about the mafia.
It was the first crack in the mafia's code of silence. William Hungley was one of the first to hear his revelations.
As soon as we got the story, we moved him up to Fort Dix, flew him up there in a helicopter. The brig up there was empty, and we put him in the brig. We started interviewing him.
Giovellacci detailed the structure of the mafia families, from his level as a soldier to the very top, the godfathers. But this information was never given by him in any criminal trials. Instead, Robert Kennedy turned to television, which was covering the sessions of the McClellan Committee.
Robert Kennedy had the brilliant idea, let's put Giovellacci on show. Giovellacci gets before the Senate Committee, and a national audience is absolutely fascinated.
The nation's underworld gets the unwelcome spotlight of publicity as the Senate's Investigation Subcommittee begins new hearings on crime. Arkansas Senator McClellan is at the helm.
William Hundley was present as Giovellacci's electrifying testimony was broadcast across the nation.
He really didn't want to cooperate. There's no doubt about that. Quite frankly, though, when he got in front of those Klieg lights up before the McClellan Committee, the adrenaline started to flow, and I think he in a sort of a perverse way that he kind of enjoyed it.
Why did you decide to kill him at that time at that spot?
Because he's the guy I spotted at that time.
He was the...
In other words, I felt that was my last day, in plain English, Senator. I felt that was my last day.
In other words, this was a defense for you. You thought that if you kill this man who you thought was going to kill you anyway, that this...
I got some satisfaction, Senator.
You got some satisfaction.
Giovellacci's testimony caused a sensation. Here, live on TV, was a mobster giving the first tantalizing glimpse into the secret world of the mafia, or, as he called it, Cosa Nostra, Italian for our thing. Giovellacci corroborated what the FBI bugs had begun to pick up and what its director, J. Edgar Hoover, had reluctantly started to believe. That a modern American criminal group used rituals and symbols from Sicily to maintain internal discipline and run its multi-million dollar enterprise.
While you were repeating the words, you were burning the paper.
Right, this is the way I burn if I expose this organization.
There's always a lot of skepticism about that, because nobody had ever come forward. And, you know, said, how you getting made and whatnot. And apparently, you know, it was exactly the way he said it was. You know, they decide who's going to get made. You get together, you burn this holy picture and whatnot. And then, bingo, you're a made member of the mafia.
He went on to explain that you live by the gun and by the knife, and you die by the gun and by the knife.
Who was chosen? Who became your godfather?
Joe Banana.
Joe Banana?
He happened to be
now,
my godfather.
Now, where is he? Is he on this chart we have here? Is he at the head of one of the families now?
Yeah, he still is.
He still is?
Yes.
Still alive?
Right.
For the American Mafia, and the Banana family in particular, Valachi's TV appearances were devastating.
Valachi's testimony was certainly a blow to the people in our world. There's no question about that.
Senator, can I say something, Senator?
Yeah.
As to what I'm telling you now, I need to go no further to say nothing else. This is what I'm telling you, what I'm exposing to you and the press and everybody. This is my doom.
Joe Valachi died in prison of cancer in 1971. He had helped shatter the view that there was no national criminal organization in the United States. Cosa Nostra could no longer act in secret at a time when they were moving more and more onto the international stage with their Sicilian cousins. For both mafias, once broken, omerta, the vow of silence, could never be as strong again.